Good morning and welcome to the third meeting of 2024 in session six of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, which is fully virtual today. We have no apologies, and can I remind all participants that you must keep your cameras on. Our broadcasting colleagues will control your microphones, so you don't need to touch these at any point. If you just watch for your mic icon to show you as being unmuted, and then take a second before you speak. Thank you. Agenda item one, the agreement to consider evidence in private. Our first agenda item is to agree to take item four, which is consideration of today's budget evidence in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you. Our second agenda item is consideration of one negative Scottish statutory instrument. That is SSI 2023/375, the Equality Act 2010, specific duties, use of member information, Scotland, revocation regulations 2023. And I refer members to paper one. Do any members have any comments to make on the instrument? There are no members who have indicated that they have any comments to make. That being the case, are members content formally not to make any comment to the Parliament on this instrument? Thank you, members, and that concludes consideration of the instrument. Agenda item three. The third agenda item is to continue our budget scrutiny. And I therefore welcome to the meeting Claire Gallagher. Good morning, Claire, who is the Human Rights Officer from the Council of Ethnic Minority Voluntary Sector Organisations, also known abbreviation as CEMVO Scotland. Morning. Professor Angela O'Hagan, Chair of the Scottish Government's Equality and Human Rights Budget Advisory Group. And Heather Williams, who is the training lead from the Scottish Women's Budget Group. And you are all very welcome this morning. As our meeting today is entirely virtual, can I remind our witnesses and members to type R in the meeting chat if they would like to come in on any questions as we go through the session. And could I also remind members to direct their questions to a particular witness in the first instance. I refer members to papers two and three and invite each of our witnesses to make some opening remarks, and we will be starting with Claire Gallagher, please. So, Claire.
Good morning, convener. Thank you very much for inviting me back again today to give evidence. As you said, my name is Claire Gallagher and I'm from the Council of Ethnic Minority Voluntary Sector Organisations. We're a national intermediary body and a strategic partner of the Scottish Government's Equality, Human Rights and Inclusion Directorate, with the aim of developing the capacity and sustainability of our sector. Overall summary and remarks for today's evidence is we're delighted to see more funding allocated towards the Equality Human Rights Fund. And I'm looking forward to discussing in more detail the increases and decreases to certain areas within the directorate. Overall, I think we've made some progress from last year, but I would like to explore again the use of data and the impact assessments in more detail and how we mainstream them in a better way for the next budget process. It was great to see some more increased participation with particular reference to the whole family equality group project and the citizens panel. They're a great group and do fantastic work. So I would like to pick up on a few of their reflections as well from their experience and how we can get more involvement within the budget process as a whole.
Thank you, Claire. And I would like to now invite Angela O'Hagan.
Good morning, convener and colleagues. Thank you very much for another opportunity to engage with the committee. I mean, as colleagues will be saying, or and as Claire has already said, the focus on participation, I think, is particularly welcome. This morning, today's session is being watched by women from a project I'm involved in on women's economic empowerment. So there's women from Glasgow Disability Alliance, Scottish Women's Budget Group, and a project at Glasgow University on women in multiple low-paid employment. And this project is around trying to build knowledge and understanding and awareness of the budget process, as well as around economic policy in Scotland. And so for women such as these, being able to be part of the process, albeit today virtually, but we have the trains to thank for that, is really important. And seeing the organisations that are starting to be involved more in the process, the budget process and the scrutiny of budget processes is really, really important. So certainly welcome the committee's endeavours on that part, along with other committees within the Parliament. Part of that process, though, of scrutiny and accountability needs also to focus on the human rights principles. Now, the process principles of participation and accountability and transparency have been the focus of the committee, but they're also, and I would urge focus on the scrutiny on the fulfilment of rights and the obligations of government to ensure the maximisation of available resources to secure the progressive realisation of rights. I would also reflect it's been a very busy year for the Equality Human Rights Budget Advisory Group, with the publication of the Scottish Government response to our previous recommendations, pushing for integration of equality and human rights analysis in the process. There have been some significant changes in the process and the documentation, and there's ongoing work in process in progress. So scrutiny by the committee and externally is very welcome, as is the informed analysis of the Scottish Women's Budget Group, SEMBO, and other NGOs who have contributed evidence already as part of the budget process, which again I would say, and I think I always say, we have an open budget process in Scotland, but it continues to be hidden in plain sight. So I would encourage this committee and other committees to maintain and keep energised a focus on transparency, accountability and participation. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Angela, for that. And I would like to move swiftly on to Heather Williams, please.
Thanks, convener, and thanks for letting us participate in this again. I'm from the Scottish Women's Budget Group, and we are a membership organisation which carries out or promotes gender analysis in public policy and public finance decisions. And tries to make that link between equalities and budget processes. Because through our work with the Scottish Government, but also with local governments, often those two things don't come together in a way that makes a difference for those that are most disadvantaged in our communities. And that for us starts with looking at the impact on women, but taking that intersectional analysis. We've carried out an analysis of the Scottish Government budget this year, looking at the Equality Fairer Scotland budget statement and other payments, other papers, carried out analysis looking at transparency, looking at participation, and that outcome focus and how it advances gender equality. And well, like Professor O'Hagan was saying, you know, we welcome the openness, we welcome the fact that these papers are available, but we still think there needs to be a better joined upness in terms of actually explaining the decisions that are taken. And that's something that we'd like to focus on in our evidence today.
Thank you, Heather, for that. And thank you to all our witnesses for their opening statements. I'd like to move straight on to questions. Some of the witnesses have given a general sort of like view of the budget. However, just regarding with funding, and this is just a question for openers, colleagues will be probing much deeper and scrutinising things much further. So it's just a one to get us started, really. But an overall reaction to the Scottish Government's funding allocations for the Equality, Inclusion and Human Rights. So I did hear that it was broadly welcome, but any further opinion on that would be quite interesting for us to hear. And I'll start with Heather first, please.
excuse me, apologies, convener, I've got a bit of a tickly throat. I'll try not to cough at you. So, I mean, I suppose for one of us, it's that thing about what, you know, when you look at the level four figures and the information that's contained in there, it's difficult to actually get a complete handle on what the funding means and what the changes and the funding for that directorate are. Often things that are funded through that directorate, so for instance the Delivering Equally Safe fund and things like that, there's not enough detail contained within the budget, the figure breakdowns, but also in terms of the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement as to actually how that funding is going to be used and what difference it's going to make. So that would be our kind of initial reaction, is that the detail is limited to actually be able to identify what impact the changes in funding is actually going to have, you know, the allocations actually going to have for the directorate.
Thank you. Thank you, Heather. Could I ask Angela if she has a view?
I think there are a number of things to say here, and I mean, what I won't be commenting on is the amount of money allocated in any portfolio. But I think just to pick up on Heather's points about the coherence across funding allocations is an area of work that still needs significant improvement. I think the reading across and between the different elements of the documentation around the budget. And I think, I mean, there have been efforts, and I know officials within government are working very hard on this, but there does need to be continuous improvement on the knowledge base and the analytical capacity within portfolios. But that also requires time and resource. So the resource of time as much as the resource of personnel. And we also need, I think, to see improved cross-portfolio working. And I think that is improving. And I think the introduction of the senior leadership group is intended to help with that coordination across different portfolios, driven by and made visible by and to the senior directorate teams. But I also think there's still, and I think this applies not just to the Scottish Government, but across policy analysis in Scotland, that there needs to be a better understanding of the structural inequalities that result in differential and different experiences, because that then has a bearing on the types of analysis that we see. And we can then see better how are decisions about allocations being made in a way that seeks to address the underlying causes of discrimination, the conditions that produce and reproduce inequalities, and rather than at the moment there is a tendency for policy analysis around inequality to focus on the very important issue of economic inequality, but not the gendered, racialised and other marginalised dimensions of that. And I think that is still missing. In terms of the scrutiny, again, part of the consequence, I think, of all of this being a work in progress and the constant drive for improvement, we've seen lots of changes all the time. And I suppose maybe that's part of my role in EBAG, is trying to capture some of those changes and keep things a bit more streamlined. Because it's difficult, as Heather has said, to try and follow the money. And the Scottish Women's Budget Group analysis is very clear on that it's difficult to follow the money. And so the 51.9 million allocation for the Equality, inclusion and human rights directive, yes, is very welcome, but across all the different documents, it's difficult to see what has been allocated for what and for what purposes. And so there does, I think, need to be some presentation improvement in the presentation. There's a lot of detail in Annex B of the Equality and Fairer Scotland Budget Statement, which I thoroughly commend to this committee and others. But again, we see some inconsistencies in the presentation of decisions around what policy and programme actions are being taken, mm-hmm. but not what is being allocated to whom for what. And yeah. The final thing I suppose I would say about the clarity in the allocations is, and this has been raised by a number of comments on the budget and since the publication of the draft budget, but also in advance, is the ongoing need for improvement in what changes have been made and what are the implications and impacts of these changes. Now, Claire mentioned, yes, it's good to see an uplift in the funding, but where is it going? That clarity still needs, and consistency in the presentation still needs to come through the documentation.
Thanks, Angela. Colleagues will be coming back to drill in further into sort of like answers and responses. Claire, did you have anything further to add? But I am going to bring in Paul O'Kane, who's going to sort of continue this line of questioning. So unless there was something that you definitely wanted to add just now, you probably will get an opportunity with my colleague, Paul.
I would just quickly like to add, I agree with what Heather and Angela have already mentioned about the consistency. I think the other thing that's missing is that transparency in the funding. So there are certain decreases in certain areas. So for example, the equalities section has a decrease, and we see an increase in the human rights section, but just being a bit transparent about the evidence of having a decrease, because there was a one sentence explanation which didn't offer a really insightful reason for the decision being made. So that would be the only thing that I would like to add, and I'm happy to have more questions in depth about the funding later on.
Thank you. Paul O'Kane, please.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. And I suppose my question will kind of follow on in this respect, but also I think not just in terms of the budget lines that we perhaps focused on in our first conversation there, but I'm keen to understand how the budget as a whole, I suppose, has been looked at in the lens of equality and human rights. So I suppose maybe my starting point is, to what extent have, you know, the decisions taken in other portfolio areas perhaps had an impact on the government's ambition to achieve its wider, you know, ambitions in terms of equality. And I wonder if there's a sense from any of the witnesses that decisions that are taken in other portfolio areas actually might entrench equalities rather than trying to combat them, combat inequalities rather. So I wonder if I might come to Heather first.
excuse me. I think in terms of, you know, from the analysis that we've carried out of the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement, and as Angela was saying, you know, there have been improvements and it is a work in progress and we absolutely recognise that. But for us, one of the things is that sometimes it's really difficult to see how equalities considerations have been taken into account when budget decisions have been made. So, for instance, one of the examples, and this is one where actually there was a recognition in the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement that there was a cut to the funding, was in relation to higher education, so further in higher education spaces. But what the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement that says is that it's difficult to say how that will impact because colleges and universities are autonomous organisations. And I suppose for me, it's like, well, I understand that colleges and universities are autonomous organisations and they will make decisions. The Scottish Government is providing funding and that must come with expectations. And I suppose that's an example of how, well, at least in that is an example of an area where there's been a reduction in funding which has been recognised within the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement. There's many others where there's been reductions or standstill funding that hasn't been recognised in the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement. So I think it's that thing about sometimes it feels a bit like, yes, we admire the problem, so we set out what the issues are, and we're really good at doing that in terms of these are the inequalities, but what we're not good at doing is that follow-up analysis. And I think that's a real issue in terms of equality impact assessment processes across the public sector in Scotland, is our analytical ability to actually join the dots and say, how is the way in which we do this, how does it help, or how does it entrench and embed inequalities? And that analysis is often the bit that's missing.
I don't know if other colleagues might want to contribute, convener. Claire, perhaps?
Thank you. Just to build on what Heather had said there, I think impact assessments is something that across the portfolios that we can really do better at, and mean having a mainstreaming approach to impact assessments. I've spoke the last couple of times here about the crucial part of impact assessments in each portfolio, and we're really good, as Heather said, explaining what the inequalities are in Scotland, but what we're not doing is, quite rightly, as Heather said, is the analysis of that, but we're also not doing what actions are we doing to address these inequalities. So what mitigating steps are we taking if we know that this is going to have a disproportionate impact on certain groups? Referring to your original question, Paul, about the decisions relating to equality as a budget as a whole, I think we can see definitely more thought going into each portfolio about equality and the impact of the decision making. But I think one example that I would like to draw upon is within the social security section. So social security have been awarded more money and an increase in their funding, which is great, but we still see in their breakdown of their data that they're still not reaching certain community groups. And I think we need to remember that in line with our human rights guidance is that we have to prioritise those whose rights are most at risk. So what are we doing to make sure that, yes, we are giving more funding to Social Security Scotland, but how are we making sure that the recipients of that payment are those whose rights are most at risk? Are we doing targeted advertisement? Are we helping people overcome the barriers to accessing that service in particular? So I think that's an area that could, and I use Social Security as an example, but across different other areas that we could really look into a wee bit more. We're giving more money, so let's make sure that we are reaching those who are furthest at risk and how we're going to do that. And that would be really good, fitting in with the principle of transparency within the budget process.
Thank you, Claire. Can I bring in Professor O'Hagan, please?
Hi there, Angela's fine, really. Paul, you asked about how the budget as a whole has been looked at from an equality and human rights perspective. And I think that's the ultimate goal, really, isn't it? That's the starting point for scrutiny. And it's the starting point for any analysis around any policy area is what is the current what are the current inequalities? What's the extent of the realisation of particular rights? Where are the gaps there? And how do we work collectively as government and across public agencies to close those gaps and to bring about the realisation of those rights? That has to be the starting point for policy making. And Scotland is not alone in that not being the starting point. But I think we're seeing, certainly, I mean, we have a strong narrative around the budget and around policy making in Scotland. And I think that has come over very strongly in this budget. The focus on values, the focus on equality. And we are seeing some, I think, significant changes in the process. They're maybe not very exciting to the outside world, but they're very exciting to me because I spend a lot of my time trying to promote these changes. And so internally, the use of those six questions around the budget, encouraging policy officials to think through what are the implications you know, what is the outcome that the policy is aiming to achieve? What did they know about existing inequalities? What difference, what impact will decisions make? How will budget decisions contribute to the realisation of rights? Can the budget be used differently to address existing inequalities? And how will it be evaluated? These are all really, really important questions. They've been around for a while. They have made a difference, I think, this year, but they need the praxis of that approach, that analytical approach, needs to be more embedded. It needs to get stronger within the portfolios and within committees. The other thing I would say is there are multiple elements. There's so many different bits of documentation around the budget process. And one of the things I would like to see is for the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement and its annexes to be much more visible as part of the full suite of budget documentation. And there's a lot of really useful information there that shows some of the workings in the margins, not all of it, but some of it, in terms of the distributional analysis, the Annex B that I've already mentioned to the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement, which in turn is informed by lots of other documents, including impact assessments, which, as colleagues have said, continues to be, you know, a process that requires a lot of improvement, both in terms of the analytical capacity and in the time that's given. But I do think these are all ways in which we can see how the budget as a whole is inching towards, you know, is improving that equality and human rights scrutiny. Quickly, a couple of other things that are important to note in this year's process. The programme for government and budget process have started to become more aligned. Now, it might sound strange to certainly to external viewers that it didn't previously happen, that the budget commissioning and programme for government all happened at the same time. So that was a major breakthrough this year when that started to happen. And one of the lessons emerging already from the current process that needs to happen in the same way, but earlier. The other innovation this year was the introduction of, sort of challenge workshops, ministerial workshops. And there was one of them was around the Equality and Fairer Budget Statement. And that brings much more scrutiny from across Cabinet into the process. And I think that has been a really important development. But obviously, I'm talking about the process issues. Colleagues from a range of external organisations have already made representations to the committee and elsewhere about the impact, which was your other question, Paul, about portfolio decisions and the knock-on effects. There does need to be, I think, much more cross-portfolio working to identify the implications of those decisions. But colleagues from Joseph Rowntree Foundation and elsewhere have highlighted the implications around child poverty and child poverty targets. Glasgow Disability Alliance and others have highlighted the impact of ongoing care charges on disabled people. Funding on social care remains a priority. And so on and so on. There are lots of things that others have commented on in relation to the knock-on effects of spending decisions.
Thank you, Angela. Can I just bring in Heather? If you could be brief, that would be really helpful. I'm just mindful of time, and we do have a range of questions that we need to get through. So I would just like to remind everyone at this point, if I could get succinct and focused answers, that will enable all of us to cover the wide range of scrutiny that we wish to undertake this morning. Heather, please.
I think just quickly in terms of that, about the impact of the budget as a whole, one of the reasons that is often difficult to see and to analyse and to be able to identify exactly how equalities have been considered is that lack of targets, that lack of, you know, as much as in the, you know, the budget documentation at a very high level, they link them to the national performance framework and the national outcomes. But actually, in terms of being able to interrogate that and identify, okay, so if we're putting money into, say, for instance, employability programmes, what do we expect that to change? Who do we expect that to benefit? What's the impact that that's going to have, and how do we assess that? And that's another bit that I think is missing that allows us to actually do that analysis of actually what impact and what change has this spending made, and is it actually making a change for the people that we want it to make a change for? Thanks, convener.
Thank you, Heather. Paul, is there anything further that you would like to ask at this point?
No, I think actually Heather answered my second question, which was just about the quality of assessment of decisions within the budget. So I actually think that's been a useful conclusion there.
Thank you. Thank you, Paul. We're going to now look at the theme of participation, and I would like to bring in my colleague, Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to witnesses. I would like to ask a question in regards to our citizen participation that is part of our human rights budget and approach. Where do you feel that that is best placed? Is the value of that best added in committees, or do you think that the Scottish Government should have a more direct role with citizen participation?
Adam, would you like to direct that to a particular...
I'll go to Claire first, please.
Thank you for your question. So I think in terms of participation this year and citizens being involved, it is a huge difference between this year and last year in the budget process when we were doing the post-budget scrutiny, and that's always welcome. I can see other involvement out with the committee as well, so I was really pleased to read that the Scottish National Investment Bank were working with Black Professionals Scotland, a great group that are doing, again, some really amazing work. So I think there are different pockets in where we can involve citizens in the budget process. I think in terms of where would it best sit, I think there's always a need for the committee to have citizens involved in the budget process. And I think it's really important for them to continue to be able to access the committee in terms of specific issues that they've raised. So I know that the citizens panel from the Whole Family Equality Project had raised some questions with yourselves for you to take to the minister. And that I think that's a really direct route to, in terms of when we talk about accountability, having that direct access, that's a really good step. But as a whole, my answer is probably both for you. But I, as a whole, I think we need to embed participation much more, like wider across the parliament and government, because we're making decisions. Budget decisions about people, and we know that a budget decision affects people in every different way. There's not two people that a budget decision will impact in the same way. So I think it would be welcome to have continue to have that direct link with the committee, but also to see it more mainstreamed across the government and parliament.
Thank you. Karen, would you like to bring Heather?
Thank you. I think just quickly, just to say, the work that the committee has done this year, I think, has been really interesting. I think that when you look at the analysis, though, of the kind of open responses that you got to the survey that was put out over the summer, I think that gives us some interesting information about that level of understanding about the budget process and about how connected people feel to it. And I would say that has come out in the work that we've done. We've been doing some work, as Angela was talking about, in conjunction with WISE at Glasgow Caledonian University, with a group of women, but we've also been doing some sessions recently with Amina in Glasgow and with Fosside Women Girls Group in East Lothian. And one of the things that people constantly say to me say is that all they see is that what they pay is going up, and they don't actually see the benefit of the taxes that they are paying. And I suppose the optimist in me would like to think that we could have really good conversations about taxation and public services and try to take some of the politics out of it. I know, as I say, that's the real optimist in me, that we can maybe actually have proper good conversations that can help people to participate and to understand the process, because it's complicated, you know, in terms of how the Scottish government, the Scottish government's funded, where the money then goes, who then implements it. There's lots of different moving parts in this process, and unfortunately, sometimes politics gets in the way. Now, I'm not naive enough to expect politicians to stop doing politics, but sometimes it would be nice if we could just have a bit of, you know, a bit less politicking and a bit more honest grown-up conversation about where we are in terms of our financial situation and the decisions that we have to take. So that's my plea.
Thank you, Heather. We hear you. And I'd like to think that actually this committee in particular, thank you for making reference to the way that we did the participation with the citizens that we had. And we got excellent feedback from them. They felt more connected to the process. So hopefully that could be rolled out across other committees. So thank you for acknowledging that. I don't see that anyone else wants to come in on that one, Karen. Would you like to continue?
Yes, thank you, convener. And on that point, it's great to get that feedback on the deliberate approach that the committee did take. And I felt as a member, it was very beneficial just to be in touch with the citizens in that way and part of an educational process as well. And on that point and the way that we proceeded with our work, do you feel that other committees would benefit from our deliberate approach and our actioned approach towards that participatory budgeting? And you've spoken a bit about cross-portfolio and collegiate working across portfolios a bit there. Do you feel that that would be beneficial for committees to be doing that as well? And can I come to Angela on that first, please?
Your previous question, Karen, was where is it best placed? You know, it's with government and with parliament. And I think cross committee, there's different things that different committees can and should be doing. I think the points that colleagues have made are really important. I think it's also important to separate out information, involvement and participation, because they're different things. And we need good information coming from the Scottish Government and coming from the Scottish Parliament that is accessible, that is in a range of formats, that supports involvement and then supports to increase participation. I don't think what's going on is participatory budgeting. It's participation in commentary around the current budget process. And I think that's an important distinction. The founding principles of the Parliament around openness and transparency, accountability and equality all should be driving this openness in understanding and participating in the budget process. And to come back to my opening point, there's different roles for different committees there. I think there's the overview of the budget process, which this committee looks at, which the Economy Committee looks at, or Finance and Economy, but then subject committees. I think we need to see a much wider range of engagement and participation in subject committees from a wider range of people around social care, around training and employment, whatever it, you know, education, whatever the policy focus happens to be. That's where I think we need to see and that needs to be an equality and human rights perspective on the allocations and spending and outcomes in the scrutiny of those committees, because it's not just, and again I've said this before, it's not just the responsibility of this committee to look at the equality and human rights dimensions, it's across all committees.
Can I bring in Claire, please?
Thank you, convener. And my point slides really nicely and after what Angela had mentioned there about it sitting, this responsibility of equality and human rights sits with all committees. And I think it was one of the points of the citizens panel that you were working with had raised that they would like to be involved in more portfolios and more committees, because we need to see the equality embedded throughout, and it's not just siloed, because if we just keep it to ourselves, we're not mainstreaming equality. One of the examples I'd like to touch upon was the introduction of the case studies and the annex, and I thought that that was a really demonstrative way of showing the impact of the budget decision, and it laid it out very clearly with the questions. But I did notice that some of the questions, there was a lot of inconsistency So for one of the questions, it related to, you know, the existing inequalities of the outcome in relation to the budget decision. And some budget areas had went on to explain each protected characteristic amongst other things, for example, socioeconomic background and the impact that had on it. But other budget areas did not do that. And I think that we need to be a wee bit more consistent. And then also that I think when we're talking about mainstream inequality throughout directorates, throughout committees and portfolios, is that we have to, it's so important to have citizens' views at the heart of that, because what you can see, and I'm going to take the drugs and alcohol budget area, for example, is when they broke down into race, they said that, you know, there was no data there to say, but we can see from England that the use of alcohol and drugs is lower within ethnic minority and communities, but that doesn't reflect that people from these communities do struggle with alcohol and drug use, and it's the barriers that they face to access those services and the fear of accessing those services that stop them prohibiting access and support. So what I'm trying to say is that demonstrated to me a lack of an awareness around the barriers that people from these communities face, really particularly on the use of drugs and alcohol. And it means that though they are the furthest away people from access and support, and in our breakdown of the budget, we didn't have anything to show for that. So I think that's why it's really important to get citizens involved to explain those barriers and the cultural differences and how we talk about drugs and alcohol, and reflecting on, you know, the barriers that they and the challenges that they specifically face within their own communities. So I think I'll leave it there.
Thank you, Claire. Karen, is there anything further that you wish to pursue before I bring in your colleague Annie?
No, that's good. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Annie Wells, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Pam. Claire spoke about this briefly in our previous couple of answers to Karen, but I was just wondering whether there was any other views on the way that ministers responded to the questions that the citizens panel developed, and in particular, focusing back again on the potential issues in mainstreaming. And I don't know whether Heather could maybe come back in on this first.
I mean, I think in terms of, you know, the questions that the panel came up were, you know, Claire's already mentioned it, but one of the things that struck me reading what the panel had said to you was that idea about recognising that people don't live their lives in silos, that the equalities and human rights impacts on all aspects of people's lives. I think some of the detail responses provided by the ministers was perhaps it could have been stronger in terms of their response to the questions. But I think part of that then it goes back to what we've been saying, which is that lack of analysis that often gets done across different portfolio areas. And I suppose it's that thing about, you know, I often talk about folk, you know, but we need to show our work hands, you know, of an age and you did maths exams, you know, that's what we were told, you had to show your work hands. I don't know if kids still get told that or not, but, you know, and that's the bit that's sometimes missing, is that, you know, difficult decisions are having to be made in terms of the priorities that the government has. And, you know, we might not always agree with those decisions that get taken. You know, so for instance, for us is the, you know, council tax freeze. We don't think that's the best way to address inequality. But, you know, that's a decision that's been taken. But the one thing in the documentation, the paperwork, there's been no explanation of that. There's no evidence. There's no information to show the workings as to why that decision has been taken. And I think sometimes that lack of cross-portfolio analysis leaves the minister not always being able to answer the questions that people have. So it is that thing about, you know, as public sector, and also sometimes third sector and private sector, we think in silos, we work in silos, and we don't always lift our heads to look at, if we do this in one area, what does that mean in another area? And that bit's often missing as well.
Thanks for that, Heather. I don't know if anyone else, if Angela or Claire, want to come back in on any of that.
I think that was a pretty comprehensive answer. I don't see any indication. Do you have any further questions, Annie?
Yes, I do, convener. The Scottish Government did promise an easy read version of Your Scotland, Your Finances, but unfortunately it's not been published just yet. But I was just wondering if you had any views on the accessibility of the 24-25 budget, and where do you see your responsibility lying for making the budget process accessible to citizens? And I think this is probably what you were speaking about, Heather, just to get citizens more involved, to get the public more involved. So I don't know whether you would... Well, I see Claire wants to come in on that one. So Claire, if you wouldn't mind answering that for me just now.
Thank you. It was actually in reference to your last question.
All right.
Challenging of mainstreaming, but I'll just briefly touch on that if that's okay. So yeah. One of the main roles that we have at SEMO Scotland is mainstreaming equality and human rights, and specifically race equality and human rights. And I think one of the challenges that we face when we work with different directorates and different groups is that within government is that the priority of equality is different everywhere. So how important is mainstreaming equality to certain directorates and portfolios? It's completely different. Their commitment to it is different. So I think we need a more strategic approach to mainstreaming and what that looks like, because what a good approach to embedding equality and human rights into our delivery looks very different across portfolios, and we need to be a much more strategic in how we're doing that. There's some directorates that are doing amazing work in terms of getting participation involvement, whether it be in co-design of services, but we're not seeing that transfer to other areas, and I think there's a lot of learning that we can do from each other around that. In relation to your question that you asked there about the promise of easy read, but that's not yet been published yet, I'm happy with the commitment of publishing an easy read, and I think we all welcome that, but it should be published at the same time. It's very hard. We know the need for an easy read document, but it's very hard to become involved in the budget process when that's not been published, and we're now at a post-budget scrutiny process. So we really have to be publishing things at the same time. And again, that reflects back on, is this a priority or is it not? And I think it would really be a priority for it to be published at the same time. One of the other areas I think that we could do to improve that is, I think the last time I was here, I spoke about, we have to relate budget decisions to people. Sometimes they can seem really far removed. Heather talked about, you know, the council freeze tax. People want to know how these decisions affect them, because it still seems like a super distant idea. People are seeing paying more in tax, to getting council fees, but they're not seeing any changes. And I think that's maybe how we can maybe do a bit of, there could be a bit of capacity building around how does it relate to you? How does it relate to your communities? Excuse me, I've also got a bit of a tickly throat. But yeah, I think the main point here is that I think we need to be having those accessible documents published at the same time to really encourage meaningful participation from our citizens. Thanks.
Thanks very much for that, Claire.
Thank you, Annie.
Heather wants to come in.
I mean, we'll probably come, there'll be plenty of opportunity. People are sort of segueing in answers to different areas, so we're going with it. So that was mainly around participation. I'm going to move us on to the area of transparency. So our contributors this morning have already mentioned transparency throughout their other answers and their opening statements, but I just want to focus in on the fact that both stakeholders and the committee made several recommendations last year on how the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement could be improved. And there have been further changes this year, including the removal of detail on how the impact of spending might have changed. So what are the, it would be interesting to know our contributors this morning, what their views are on those changes, and do they increase or reduce transparency? So I'm going to come to Heather first, please.
As Claire mentioned, one of the changes this year is the case study approach that's been taken, and that's been quite an interesting approach. But I think, again, in terms of transparency, it's that, you know, kind of showing your, again, going back to that, showing your work in terms of, I'll give an example. So one of the case studies that they provided was around employability. When you look at education and skills budget, the employability budget has reduced. Now, part of that is potentially, I'm assuming, is to do with with Fair Start Scotland ending and No One Left Behind taking over. But within the case study and within the Annex B information, there is no there's no explanation of that in terms of that reduction, or what looks on the face of it as a reduction in funding, and what the impact of that will be. It will be so, while that case study approach is welcome in terms of trying to provide some understanding of the decisions that have been taken, I would say that for a couple of areas, the level of information that's been provided is it doesn't actually link to the budget decisions that have been taken this year. And I think that's something that we need to get better at, is actually the information that's provided. How does the decisions that have been taken in this budget, how do they either address inequality, or how potentially can they embed and entrench it further? Thanks, convener.
Thank you, Heather. Would either Claire or Angela like to come in on that one? They may wish to come in on the next one. The committee intends to focus its pre-budget scrutiny of 2025-26 on transparency. So it'd be really useful for us to hear what our contributors this morning, what priority issues be in this area for us. So it's sort of, you know, what would you like us to consider is paramount on that. Could I bring in Angela, please?
Thank you very much, convener. There is quite a lot to say on transparency, partly as well because there's quite a lot going on. I agree with Annie Wells' comments. I miss Your Scotland, Your Finances. I think we definitely need, both from Parliament and from government, those kind of easy read, accessible, summarising reports. But there is work going on in and around that. There is a separate from the Equality and Human Rights Budget Advisory Group. There's another project running around fiscal transparency. And that's looking at publication of information on Scotland's public finances on a big scale. It's a huge project. It's been running for a while. It's the impetus behind it was open government. And it's really worth following through on what's coming out of that project, and both in terms of the products that will change as well as the information that's going to be coming, being made more available, more accessible, more understandable. The next step, though, I think, is for some of the work within that project to loop back through the budget process much more. The comments that colleagues have made on the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement and the new innovations and iterations this year, I think, are really well made and will certainly form part of our discussions on our lessons learned meeting in a couple of weeks' time in EBAG, where we look back on what differences have been trialled this year, what has worked well, what's worked less well, some of the omissions and changes have meant. And I think there's a very strong message there that there needs to be not just the really important follow through across the documentation, but as this committee, as many contributors to this committee and elsewhere have reiterated, including Audit Scotland, there needs to be much more attention to when changes and allocations are made, what are the impacts. And so we'll certainly be taking that back. And I think for the committee to be looking for those kinds of changes as well. But I think it would also be very helpful to hear from the committee as you work towards and then through your pre-budget scrutiny around transparency, what information you use, how you use it. And so what would be helpful to see in future iterations. The other thing I would encourage the committee to look for in its pre-budget scrutiny on transparency is to draw on what will be published probably in March, is the Scottish Human Rights Commission's forthcoming analysis on using the Open Budget Initiative, looking at transparency in the budget process. This is the second time that the Commission has run this exercise. They're in the process of finalising the analysis there, and that will be published in March. That will be really helpful for the committee's next steps. I mean, I think for me, the priorities for engagement will be looking for, and already officials within government are saying they recognise the need to bring forward the process that aligns programme for government and budget commissioning. As colleagues, particularly Heather and Claire, have pointed out, the need for alignment to read across budget documentation. And I think because, there, as Heather said, there's lots of moving parts, there's lots of documentation, but that's, I think, where the and I know that officials are working really hard on trying to get this alignment, but that also needs better cross-portfolio working and leadership and engagement from the Exchequer. And that one of the things that the Scottish Human Rights Commission Open Budget Initiative is likely to flag, which has been flagged previously, is about timely in-year publications around changes to the budget. And yeah, I think that's a long enough list for you for now.
Thank you for that extensive but very useful list. Thank you very much. Can I bring in Claire, please?
Thank you, convener. I think my point picks up on a lot from what Heather had said. For me, the priority would be explaining why decisions are made. And I think it's a really fundamental part of the budget process and being able to, for people to understand and increase their knowledge and awareness of the budget process. We know, as Heather said before, sometimes difficult decisions are made, but I think we need to be a wee bit more transparent about that. So, for example, I spoke about it in my introductory summary about, you know, the increase, when we look at it from a whole, there is an increase of funding to the Equality and Human Rights and Inclusion Directorate, which is always welcome. But we, when we look at it a wee bit more thoroughly, we see a decrease in certain areas. So, for example, the Equalities pot of money has decreased by 2% this year. Now, there's a couple of points I would like to make. Equalities is so vast that it's kind of hard to understand who this impacts and what the impact would be, because we have disability rights, women's rights, the race sector, all fall within that part. But there's also an increase in the human rights budget, and quite a significant increase of 63%, which as a human rights officer, I'm always welcome of more money allocated to human rights. What I would like to see prioritised is an explanation of the working to see, to understand a little bit more. We know that the Human Rights Bill is progressing really quite quickly in government just now, which is really welcome and well needed. But the impact that this has on the equalities sector, as we've labelled in the budget, what does that mean? Now, that could well mean that we need to start building our capacity in viewing equality issues as human rights issues. We still kind of sit in these silos. So, for example, viewing racism as a human rights issue, viewing women's rights as a human rights issue, is there money within the human rights pot with that increase going to look at these directed, targeted areas? Because we need to remember that we're incorporating international law into Scots law, and that means that we should follow guidance where needed from these bodies, and that all of these conventions call for the prioritisation of these groups, whether it be persons with disabilities, whether it be for women or people from an ethnically diverse background. So I think we have to, what I would like to see prioritised next year is to show the working and explain the reasoning behind that. And the reasoning behind the decrease in equalities might be because we're putting the money up in human rights and that's how we're going to fit it in. But that wasn't offered, and that's just a speculation that might not be true. But that would help with the transparency moving forward for next year. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Claire. I think you're right to highlight the challenges that exist around intersectionality. And then on the other side of that, of course, you've got silo working. So to actually sort of incorporate one and break down the other one has been something that I think many people have grappled with over a long time. Moving on very nicely onto the area of accountability, I'm going to bring in my colleague, Maggie Chapman. Maggie, please.
Thank you very much, CoCab, and thank you to the panel. Good morning. Really appreciate your comments so far this morning. All of you have touched on the importance of accountability, and I just want to delve into that in a little bit more detail. You've said that it's difficult sometimes to follow the money, and CoCab's comments just there around, you know, the siloing issues. I'm wondering, Could you just say, give us your views on the links that you see or don't see within the budget documentation and process, the links to Programme for Government asks, and I suppose also importantly, the National Performance Framework as well. Are we closing the gaps? Are there clear lines of accountability at different levels of government? And can I go to Heather first?
Thanks, Maggie. In terms of, I suppose for us, that accountability element in terms of how funding's been allocated in terms of the impact that it's going to have on the outcomes, that's an area where there still needs to be some improvement. Obviously, documentation tells us at very high level in terms of which outcomes that directorate will aim to achieve. Or the funding will support, and it also sets out in terms of human rights what human rights obligations it will support. But that link between specific pieces of funding and what we hope that is going to achieve and how that's going to address those things is not always clear. And that's something that certainly we would like to see addressed. One of the things as well that we would like is that in terms of if something's mentioned in the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement, I want to know what's been allocated to that. So, for instance, in this year's document, there's things like National Advisory Council of Women and Girls is mentioned. There's things like the Women's Health Plan. There's action plans like that. But there's no mention of what that funding has been, you know, what's been allocated, and has that increased? Has that decreased? And what are we hoping to achieve with that? So there's still work to be done in terms of how budgetary decisions are actually impacting on the national outcomes. And we still have a number of national outcomes where there is little data provided in terms of being able to monitor them. So an example in the report that we did was around the funding in relation to modern apprenticeships. So under, again, the education and skills, in Annex 2, it talks about the funding that's been provided, about the work, the gender budgeting work that was done, a number of years ago now. But there's nothing about what impact has the funding that was given to address that gender segregation and issues in relation to disabled people and people from Black and minority ethnic communities accessing modern apprenticeships. So we've had funding for 5 years, but there's no information about what difference has that made. And then, so that's part of it for me, that in terms of accountability, we're still not joining the dots between the funding that's provided and the impact that it's having.
Okay, and I suppose as we look ahead to human rights legislation and that kind of thing, that link between funding and outcome and impact is going to be even more important. Angela, I know you want to come in on this too.
Thanks very much, Maggie. Yes, I mean, I would wholeheartedly agree with Heather's comments just now as well. I think the relationship using the National Performance Framework as an overarching framework that justifies actions and requires the evaluation of outcomes and progress towards those outcomes, I think is an area that needs real improvement, and that the documentation around all of that needs to support that process, which I think sometimes gets a little bit overshadowed in other very welcome policy pronouncements that have had a very effective, a very useful framing effect this year. I think that has been very helpful, whether that's been, you know, from the Butte House Agreement through to the policy prospectus in the spring. These have all been very helpful framing devices. But the NPF, the National Performance Framework, is what's meant to anchor all of that. And I think there needs to be a lot more clarity and, you know, kind of robust, you know, much stronger linkages. I think we have seen a significant shift in the narrative and understanding around the relationship across portfolios and in the relation, you know, as I say, these kind of framing narratives around equality and human rights. We are seeing significant improvements quietly in the processes behind the scenes, but where we do still need significant improvement is to read across the documentation. And I think particularly picking up from what Heather was saying about in the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement, there's some very useful description around what are the programmes, but there's not enough detail either on what the value of those allocations and to where they're directed and where they're to be found in the budget. And so that's certainly something I'll be working with colleagues on. I think it needs to tie much more explicitly into Annex B, which Spice has made a couple of points about how, you know, it's a very dense document and is challenging to analyse. I think we need to recognise the value of Annex B in the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement. There's a huge amount of work has gone into this, and I think it needs to be better used, to be better understood, and to better understand, well, what are its deficiencies and which can be improved upon, rather than saying on the one hand we want lots of detail, and then when the detail is provided saying, well, it's too dense. But perhaps some of the answers there are about better improving the connections between those documents, which all of course have to tie back to draft budget. And finally, evaluation is I think the next big development, really, in terms of the process improvements. But your final point there, Maggie, was about human rights and taking an approach whereby we collectively, where resourcing allocations are made in such a way that they ensure that we are respecting, protecting and fulfilling human rights obligations. And that is the evaluation framework as well. To what extent have human rights been respected, protected and fulfilled in the allocation, spend and outcomes? So the frameworks are there. I think there's a question of building capacity within the Scottish Government and with all respect within Parliament as well, on how those frameworks are effectively operationalised. And we have, you know, great opportunity with the Incorporation Bill, but that again needs resource in terms of building capacity and giving people the time to improve their expertise.
Thanks, Angela. That's really, really helpful. I might come back on a couple of points, but I know Claire wants to come in on this too.
Thank you, Claire. I'm just pointing out to members and to our contributors that we were scheduled to finish this meeting at 11. Whilst I can allow a little bit of leeway, I would just like to focus people's minds on succinct answers. There is no need to repeat, and that goes for members because we have questions coming up that may have already been covered. So in that vein, briefly, please, Claire.
Thank you, Convener. Very briefly, to lead on from what Angela had said there, I think for the most part, we can see which national outcomes link to specific portfolio areas, but it's unclear how this links to the spending. And one of the things that was drawn on my mind was, how do we evaluate this? How do we link national performance framework, national outcomes, and how we are protecting, respecting and fulfilling human rights? And to me, it comes down to there's a lot of linking that can be done. So the framework is there, but for example, if you're providing funding to maybe the Equality and Human Rights Fund, how are we making sure that those outcomes all link to human rights? And how do we make sure that those outcomes are also linking to our national outcomes and our national performance framework? There's an exercise to be done to link them all together, and you can do that. Terms are used like key performance indicators, and that's how we can trace it. And I think we always need to remember that our national outcomes and our national performance framework are all embedded because we want to protect and respect our human rights. So they're all there. It's just joining up the dots, I think, would be a really useful exercise moving forward.
Thanks, Claire. Thanks for that. I think there's clearly some work for us to do on this, some digging into the looking back understanding, so we can focus and make those links. Kokeb, I'll leave it there.
Thank you, Maggie. That's appreciated. I'm going to move swiftly on to Fulton McGregor, please.
Hi, thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Yeah, just as the convener said there, I think the areas that I was going to ask about, a lot of it you have covered, and I think actually the responses have been very full, so I really appreciate that. But there is a particular question I do want to ask, and that is about, I suppose it's about this committee itself and the scrutiny that we do. All of you said in your opening speeches, which I found were really helpful, actually, but all of you also mentioned, thank you for having us back again, and thank you for becoming able to speak again. And you are all familiar faces to this committee. It's great to see you again. And as a member of the previous Equalities Committee, I know many of you from the last session as well, so you are used to coming to committee. So my question is around, how do you think the government responds to committee work like this? They'll obviously be watching it, they'll be watching the sessions, they'll be reading our reports, but do you feel that the input you give to us as a committee and then what we put forward as a report, do you think that has any impact on the human rights budgeting process? Do you feel that our recommendations, do you see a link between what we say in our committee reports based on your evidence and then actions? So I'm wondering if any of you want to speak to that? Happy with
Well, I'll pick somebody.
Yeah, cool. You do that, but yeah, sure.
In fact, I would like to give all our contributors this morning. That'll probably be the last question, I think. So I think I'll give you the opportunity to respond. I'll start with Heather first, please, followed by Angela and then Claire. Thank you.
Yeah, how to answer that? I think the impact that committee reports have can be, that's the bit that's still not entirely clear either. So, Angela talked about earlier about accessibility documentation. So the responses that the Scottish Government made to all of the committees this year, it was, there was a supplementary document provided, and it wasn't always 100% clear how what they'd actually done with the suggestions that were being made. So, for instance, and I know this is not for yourself, but the Finance Committee made a suggestion that there should be comparative actual year-on-year spend because of the in-year changes that there's been, and that's not something that we've seen provided. The recommendations that you've made, I think if we're honest, some of those recommendations have been similar for a number of years in terms of transparency, accountability and participation. But I think that this work is a work in progress, as Angela was saying, that that we are, at a point of building capacity and increasing understanding of it. So as much as some of it has been similar things being recommended for a period of time now, I do think we do see some improvements, but there's definitely some way to go. So I'll leave it there and see what everybody else wants to say.
Thanks, Heather. Can I bring in Angela, please?
Thanks, Convener. Yes, definitely work in progress. Yes, Bolton, repeated visits, repeated asks. Sometimes I do feel like a hologram. I've been in this process a very, very long time, but I would have had to chuck it if I didn't see that there were some changes, and that would be even more soul destroying. The committee scrutiny is really important to try and help present and maybe understand, from my perspective as chair of EBAC, some of the hidden behind the scenes developments that are going on. It's really important to get the feedback from committee and from colleagues. The external evidence that the committee scrutiny is an opportunity for is really important, and a really important driver for change, because it's not just me or others in an advisory group setting, but we're drawing on that evidence that highlights the omissions and deficiencies in the process, but also highlights where progress has been identified, where it's been positively received, and what lessons there are for improvement. And I know that not just the women from the Women's Empowerment Project are watching intently, and that's a huge part of the scrutiny and building that awareness, but I know that the Secretariat of EBAG will be watching very intently. What I also hope is that the reports and the scrutiny and the interest around committee activity, and by that I mean the externals, is also as intently watched and received by the leadership panel within, or the senior leadership group within government, and senior directors, because that's where the changes need to happen in processes. And much of the asks have been repeated, and I know because I repeat them. We also have to, and this isn't an apology, it's a recognition that there is there are significant resource limitations on this work, and that's because there aren't enough people to do all the things that are required in government, really. And a lot of these changes have been down to a very small number of people, and that's why the pressure from committee is very helpful, but it also needs the leadership of the directorate of Scottish Government, and indeed of the Cabinet. And that's where we've seen some changes as well, at the political level as well, in terms of that engagement, and that is really important. Finally, yes, it's good to be back, but there are others with other views as well. And I think that's part as well of the diversity of opening up perspectives and experience within the scrutiny and transparency process. So there are others out there who have plenty to say about all of this.
Thanks, Angela. Claire?
Thanks, Convener. I won't take up too much of time. I think Heather and Angela provided a useful synopsis and answer to the question. I think it's one of the biggest things we have to acknowledge, that it and the key theme I've taken away from today, it's really hard to trace the impact. And I find that quite difficult. There are some recommendations that have been taken forward and some things that we've said that have moved, and that's great. And these forums are so, so important to be able to do that. But there are things that, you know, I know that the committee has recommended a few times now. I know I've certainly sat here a few times and badgered on about impact assessments and how we need to improve the use of impact assessments and mainstream impact assessments. And it's not a committee-specific issue or a directorate-specific issue. It is across the board. And I think that's one of the areas that I would really like to see have more of an impact, because I know that we've all mentioned that numerous times, and it's one small thing, but impact assessments aren't necessarily very difficult. It's just getting the framework right in place and using the resources. My catchphrase is always, we don't want to do more work, but it's about changing the way that we work and our processes and the way that we are working, because resources are tight. We all know that, and nobody would expect more from the amazing work that people are already doing. And I'll just leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you, Claire. Fulton, are you content with those responses? Would you like to come back in? You are content. Thank you very much for that. And on that note, that does conclude our formal business this morning. And I thank all of our contributors for joining us today and playing such a valuable part in our job of being scrutineers. So once again, thank you very much for your attendance. And I hope you have an enjoyable rest of the day. We will now be moving on to private, and we'll be going on to MS Teams to consider the remaining items on our agenda. Thank you, colleagues.